In part 6 I've done a very basic tape demonstration. I've read some data records from tape into memory and then printed it out using the manual storage printout mode. In part 5 we've printed a nicely formatted list from some data cards, and today we are going to try the same using a magnetic tape. We have a tape which already contains some personal data, a personal number with 6 digits, a surname with 12 characters, and the first name with 16 characters. We'd like to print a formatted list with a nice header line, a separator line, a column for the number, 10 characters for the first name and 12 characters for the surname, each separated by some spaces. For filling these columns we will need some word marks. We also could set the word marks in the tape buffer, but I've now decided to put them into the print buffer. Printing will of course be done from the print buffer, which starts at address 201. And for the tape buffer we'll use some memory beginning at address 401. Considering that we only want to use a part of the names, we can now determine the source addresses in the tape buffer and the destination addresses in the print buffer. Keep in mind that the 1401 often defines data by referencing the high address of the data field. Since we also need to store the table header and the separator line, let's also note down their addresses. Let's put them into the 700 area. We now have defined the memory layout, so we can start to develop the program. Let's go the classic way and draw a flow diagram. We need to clear the buffers from all data. Of course the print buffer, but also the tape buffer, because it may still contain some old word marks. Then move the table header to the print buffer, issue the print command, get the separator line, print it, again clear the print buffer and set the required word marks. In the main part we can now try to read one record from tape, and if we didn't reach the end of the tape, we can now move the required parts from the tape buffer to the print buffer and issue the print command, and then try to read the next record. If we have reached the end, again clear the print buffer one last time and print the separator line again. Now that we've defined the program, we continue to translate it into machine language. This can be done by using some nice forms, but we'll simply note it down into the diagram. Clear the buffers, print the header and set the word marks, read the tape, transfer the data to the print buffer and print it, and at the end print the separator line again as a footer and stop. The interesting part is to handle the end of our data. A tape can contain several data records, but often the data doesn't fill the tape completely. More or less tape may be left after the last record. So we need a way to detect the end of our data. For example, we could store some magic data into our last record and then see if we reach this by comparing the contents. This is of course a standard problem, so there's a more sophisticated way to do this. There's a special command to write a so-called tape mark, a small record with only one special character. And when reading, there's also a special branch command, which reacts to such a tape mark and allows a change of program flow. Our tape contains such a tape mark and we will use it to end our loop. At this point we encounter a small problem. We have to branch to another location in memory, but we currently don't know the exact address. The same problem occurs at the jump at the bottom of the loop, where we need to know the address of the loop start, in this case the read tape command. To obtain these addresses we would have to count the bytes of the preceding commands, but I will use another solution. I've prepared a special spreadsheet which allows us to use labels, and it automatically calculates the addresses. And even more, it creates the data for the resulting punch cards, using that IBM format shown in part 8. By copying these lines into a text file, we can now import them as punched cards into the simulation. Let's read them into memory. We put them into the card reader, set the 1401 to run, hit start reset, hit load on the card reader, and the cards get read. Now here's the tape with the data. Put it onto drive 1. Load, start, close door. Show the paper, and the preparations are finished. The last command on the cards was a 4-character stop command with a jump address. So I now can simply press start to call our program. And here you see the nicely formatted list. Let's have a look at the program at address 501. And the header strings at address 701. We even could rewind the tape and restart the program. So reset, rewind, start. Set instruction register to 501. Start reset, run mode, and start.